probably the toughest short track in the whole country.
Let's face it, this is where we all come from, and we should all be good at it, so I really enjoy getting back to the short track.
Everyone, I'm John Kernan. Coming up on RPM tonight, Robert Presley lands a Winston Cup ride for next season. It's the same news for Ralph Schumacher in Formula One, and we'll check in on the trucks as they qualify at the Martinsville Speedway. But first, NASCAR has run at the Martinsville Speedway since its inception, so it's only fitting that one of NASCAR's longest-running teams holds the record for victories there. The Petty team has accounted for 16 trips to victory lane at the Speedway, and in qualifying, the Petty Blue came through again. We head out to the track. Jeff Gordon's fans were trying to cheer him on, but the current points leader and defending series champ managed just the 10th fastest lap of the day at 93.161. Dale Earnhardt, who is looking to snap his streak of 10 straight with no top fives, qualified 19th. That means he has to pit on the backstretch. 98 car finished fourth in the spring Friday. The new driver, John Andretti, qualified in the sixth position. A very strong run for him. Also a strong run for Morgan Shepherd, qualifying at 93.318 miles an hour. Rusty Wallace landed the outside pole with a lap at 93.882 miles an hour. He gets the Busch Pole Award because the Kings driver Bobby Hamilton won his second pole of the year, but he doesn't have the Busch beer sticker on there. Afterwards, he talked to Bill Weber.
Well, here he is again, Bobby Hamilton on the pole. Congratulations.
Hey, thanks, man. These guys did a great job. I mean, we unloaded. We was good. We was pretty fast, and then the six and the two, they just kept pulling off quick times. And we had a problem right in the middle of the corner, getting up off the corner, and Robbie just kept working on it. And, I mean, he'd done some drastic changes today. The car, it's a new car, and the thing really come to life. I mean, I'm just really glad for them because we've took a couple provisionals the last few weeks, and it's a change.
Great week for Pontiac last week, Bobby, and a pole here.
Yeah, it's just people just don't realize what this does for a race team. I mean, them guys will get jacked up. The pit stops will be a little better in the race and things like that. It just makes everybody put a lot of effort in. But it's another good weekend for Pontiac, and it needs to be. You know, it's well deserved. Them guys have worked hard in the wind tunnel trying to get us better equipment. So we just got to dig, see if we can win the race now.
Do we have to get you your own race in February since you're not in the Clash? Would that help you out?
It ain't so bad because I always spot for Sterling, but I got to hurry up and help him get a pole where I'll have somebody to spot for. That's what I like doing is spotting for it. I don't really care nothing about running. It's a great race. But I'm telling you, the race fans are like me. I'd rather watch it than be in it. But, if we could ever get in it, I'd like to. Rusty don't like to run Daytona that much, so I'm going to see if he'll let me drive his car in it.
Okay, Bobby Hamilton on the pole, still not officially in the Busch Clash. We'll have to wait and hear about that.
And we're still waiting, Bill. We're trying to explain this. His car does not have the Busch beer sticker on it, so he is not eligible for the Busch Clash. Richard Petty said earlier this year when they won the pole of Michigan, his mother never wanted to advertise beer on their race cars. He continues to honor her wishes. But Wallace, who qualified second, gets the Busch Pole Award. He doesn't, however, get an automatic spot in the Clash. He may get a wild card. Not too comforting for a guy who thought he'd win the pole.
Practice and I ran at 17 qualifying, so a little off. Track was a little slicker, but all in all, it's a pretty good run.
Think you had a shot at it?
Yeah, I really did. I really honestly, after my first lap, thought my second lap was going to be quicker, and it didn't happen.
Yeah, I'm happy with that. That'll give us a good starting spot. The car's working real good this weekend. I feel real good about it. We feel like we might be able to hang pretty tough here Sunday, hoping.
And you're starting near the front.
Yeah, I think that's important here, you know. You can kind of run the race you want to run. Don't have a lot of traffic to wear your brakes out, and obviously that's a concern of ours. It's a problem we had here in the spring, so we wanted a good effort here. We weren't that good when we got here. These guys worked awful hard today.
It's not a perfect run by any means, but yeah, it'll get us in hopefully a top 10, and we'd like to qualify on the front straightaway, and it looks like we'll be on the front straightaway. That's all you can hope for.
Great run for Bill Elliott. He starts ninth while the Labonte brothers make up row number six. Terry was a thousandth of a second quicker than Bobby. Kyle Petty started on the outside pole in the spring at Martinsville. He rolls off seventh on Sunday with a little bit different game plan this time.
We still got a good car. You know, that's not the problem. The problem is we just got set tires that was a little bit looser than what we had wanted. So you just got to bide your time now and just be patient first of the race.
We're one of the fastest cars in the practice this morning. And You know, I just know I can go faster than that. I was hoping I was going to pick up a tenth, not lose a half a tenth, you know. And anytime we go somewhere and we lose a little bit of time qualifying, you know, we're not going to be as happy as we'd like to be.
You know, I usually race good if I get in a race, but it's been really hard for me to get in the race here. So the guys did a great job with the car. We did a lot of work since we were here last time in the motor development end of it, and we might have a little fun here on Sunday.
Practiced real good. Then something happened to the engine. I don't know what. Just when I left the pit, the whole, you know, coming to get the green, I thought, this thing doesn't sound right. Then it broke.
Top 18 qualifiers all get to pit on the front stretch. Here's a look at the guys who made it, including Wally Dallenbach Jr. Of course, he failed to qualify for the race at Martinsville in the spring. Starts 14th. Dale Earnhardt missed making the front stretch by just 9 thousandths of a second. 25 drivers made the field on Friday. Second round qualifying is on tap Saturday. The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series runs in Martinsville on Saturday afternoon, and there are several Winston Cup drivers competing in the race, including Hamilton, who decided that one pole a day was just not enough. Rich Bickle tried to put himself on the pole position for Saturday's race in Richard Petty's truck, but wound up only third fastest. Darrell Waltrip just 0.7 mph slower than his Winston Cup effort. He qualifies outside the front row. Alongside Hamilton, who made it a pole sweep 92.101 mph, he says he owes this pole to his Cup team as well.
Cup team come up here Thursday during practice and fell in there and helped me quite a bit on the truck too. So just everybody put a lot of effort in and it sure made it easy on me, so I'm happy.
It'll be a huge weekend for you, Bobby.
I hope. At least one of them, please. Just anything, just one.
This is Hamilton's first ever start in a NASCAR Craftsman truck race. In fact, he said the first time he sat one of those trucks was on Thursday. Jimmy Hensley, who lives just a few miles away from the Martinsville Speedway, qualified in the fourth spot. Nathan Butke and Butch Miller round out the top six. The points leader, Ron Hornaday, starts from the inside of row number four. Back at the front row, old DW wants everybody to know he's in that number five truck.
Last night, I went to a dinner. Everybody said, boy, your truck's running terrible. What's wrong with it? It's not handling, it's not running. I said, man, I don't understand. I was in the top three or four all day. Said, I kind of hung around a while, and I finally figured they were talking about the 17 truck. I said, whoa, time out. I'm in the five. I'm in the diehard. I'm in the pumpkin.
I guess these trucks are actually made for tracks like this. I think a truck race, you know, now don't tell anybody, but a truck race is going to be more exciting than the Cup race.
Well, you know, earlier today we went ahead and put stickers on and tried to qualify and run, and we were real tight. Didn't change nothing. A little bit of air pressure. Went back out with a qualifying run, and the thing was just really loose. Loose through the middle and loose off. So, yeah, we're pretty happy with it. You know, we know what we got to do for the race tomorrow. So wherever we qualify, as long as we made the race, we'll make a show out of it.
Checking out more of the Haynes 250 grid, Harry Gant in the 15th position alongside Mike Skinner. Then it's John Nemechek and Dave Resendez. Winston Cup regular Jeff Burton starts from the 19th spot, while last year's race winner Joe Ruttman starts all the way back in 25th after qualifying at 90.120 mph. Thursday night, Richard Petty said he had paid the ticket given to him as a result of an incident on the interstate last week. Hit and run and reckless driving charges were thrown out, and Petty paid $65 in court costs for following too closely. It also cost him 4 points on his driving record. Walter Salas Jr. will make the move from Indy Lights to IndyCar next season. He'll drive for the new Gerald Davis team. Davis was the team manager for Jim Hall. The team is taking over the former Hall operation, and many of that crew will work for the new team. It's a 3-year contract for Salas, but no sponsor has been named yet. The team will run a Raynard chassis, but they are still working on an engine package. Later on RPM tonight, the Busch Series has the weekend off. We'll find out what the points contenders are up to, and we'll also get the latest from Estoril as Formula One practice opens. First fastest lap in qualifying on Friday. He'll have a new crew chief next year. We'll have more on that in a few minutes. DW, 26 fastest in first round, but was only 68 thousandths of a second away from making the top 18. Rick Mast, who normally qualifies well at Martinsville, was just 30th fastest. Mast clocked in at 20 and a half seconds. That's 92.371 mph. Across the Atlantic, the Formula One teams took to the track at Estoril in preparation for Sunday's Portuguese Grand Prix, and it could turn out to be the defining weekend in Damon Hill's career. After finishing second in the points the last 2 years, Hill can clinch his first F1 title on Sunday. But Michael Schumacher, who has stolen the championship from him the last 2 years, stole a little bit of the spotlight during practice by posting the quickest lap of the session. His Ferrari teammate Eddie Irvine was fourth quick. John Alesi was clocked at 1:24.803. That was just 29 thousandths of a second quicker than Gerhard Berger. Aside from practice, there's also a bit of news coming from Estoril. And for more on that, Here's James Allen.
It's been quite a day for the Schumacher family. While his younger brother Ralph was confirmed on a three-year contract with Jordan Peugeot starting in 1997, double world champion Michael Schumacher set fastest time for Ferrari ahead of Sunday's Portuguese Grand Prix. Schumacher overcame a throttle problem to beat championship points leader Damon Hill by 7/10 of a second today. Rumour abounds that Hill will be Ralph Schumacher's Jordan teammate next year, but the 36-year-old Englishman is dodging questions, focusing on clinching the world title this weekend. If he finishes ahead of current teammate Jacques Villeneuve, the title is his. Hill was troubled by poor handling today, but is confident that he can take pole position tomorrow. A surprising third fastest today was Ukio Katayama in the Tyrrell Yamaha. Tyrrell has new suspension this race, and they arrived here full of confidence after a very fast test at Silverstone last week. Katayama's teammate, Mika Salo, was eighth quick, amid rumours that Jackie Stewart is trying to buy him out of his Tyrrell contract for next year. Benetton and McLaren both had off days today, with Alesi and Berger 6th and 7th respectively for Benetton, Mika Hakkinen and David Coulthard 9th and 14th for McLaren. Psychologically, Hill says he feels strong this weekend, and the ball is very much in his court. With Villeneuve needing to win both here and in Japan in 3 weeks' time, the advantage clearly lies with Hill. It's crunch time in Portugal on Sunday.
Coming up on RPM tonight, Ricky Rudd is getting a new crew chief next year. We'll have that plus more news from Martinsville next. The Martinsville area on Saturday. So if second round time trials happen to be rained out, Ward Burton would be the last driver to make it by virtue of his qualifying time. 42 cars attempted to make the field on Friday, including Ricky Craven, who was just 38th fastest. Remember, he won the pole at Martinsville back in April. Of course, qualifying was the headline at the Martinsville Speedway on Friday, but as always seems to be the case, there were other things going on as well. And for more on that, we go back to Bill Weber.
Well, John, as we head into the final third of September, we can clearly see the stretch drive of the Winston Cup season. And 1997 is coming into sharper focus as well. Several drivers and crew chiefs have landed their roles for next season. Well, Friday at Martinsville, two more positions were assigned. One a surprise, but one kind of predicted. Robert Presley moving into the 29 car next season. And a surprise, Jim Long will be the new crew chief for Ricky Rudd.
We announced this weekend a crew chief change, and it was a real tough decision to make. You know, Richard is a super good guy. We just weren't getting the results, and Richard and I had a long talk about it, and, you know, I think he's very talented, and it just wasn't clicking. And it's been a very good working relationship, but we just weren't getting results. And real excited with the addition of Jim Long coming on board.
Well, I'm going to try awful hard. I'm going to go in there with a game plan and try to see what he has and get used to him in that, and I think I can make him better. We'll just have to see. He's a proven winner. The pressure's on me, not him.
We've had several meetings before we ever really discussed him driving the car to see how we could communicate within the two of us, and it seems all indications right now everything seems to be pretty good. His head's in the right place. He's more dedicated to wanting to drive a race car than be whatever. You know, swapping drivers every week, it's been kind of fun, but it's getting tiring.
Be around some of my favorite people, Fred Flintstone, Barney Rubble, and Scooby-Doo, and George Jetson. Looking real forward to that, I tell you. That fits right in with me. Bill's the one that really talked me into this deal, you know. He didn't promise me a ton of money like rumors has it. Didn't tell me had a golden gate over there. He just told me he was wanting to build a race team, and that's what I want to do.
Now, several drivers are still rumored to be making a move in 1997, including Ken Schrader, Ricky Craven, and maybe even Derek Cope. Next week, we go to North Wilkesboro, where the track and the race should be the story. But in 2 weeks, we visit Charlotte Motor Speedway, normally a home for major announcements that could sew up who's sitting where in 1997. John?
Thank you, Bill. When we come back, our panel of experts tell us just how tough the Martinsville Speedway is on both man and machine.
I think before we talk about this week, we have to go back to last week. 500 laps around the Monster Mile at Dover, Delaware. It was a very long day, and we saw tempers flare. But we've seen that here at Martinsville before, and this is just a half-mile track. At Dover, we finally got to the point where there were almost two grooves. But here at Martinsville, there's one very preferred groove. And Dr. Jerry Punch, it can really be a fight just to get to the finish here.
No doubt about it, Bill. Martinsville's a tough racetrack. You know, it's the smallest and the tightest, and it's probably one of the most competitive, arguably the most competitive racetrack, short track on the NASCAR Tour. I've been coming here for a long time. I came here as a little boy. I remember even Benny Parsons racing here years ago when I was just real, real small. And, folks, even in those days, this place was tough. The beating and banging. Hey, Dover, they had a mile to get around. Had plenty of room here. You don't have a lot of room. You got one groove, as you said, Bill, and you got curb on the inside and you got concrete on the outside, and you either go through them or over them. It's hard to go around them. That's how tough Martinsville Speedway really is here, Bill.
And it's even tougher if you have to come from the backstretch. 25 guys locked into the field in Friday's qualifying. 18 of them will pit on the front stretch. But, Benny, the rest of them have to start on the backstretch, and that makes life very difficult.
Bill, I tell you what, if that pace car just maintains that same speed around the racetrack, it's absolutely a kiss of death having to pit on the backstretch. But if NASCAR speeds up the pace car and tries to level out the pit roads, if they get it right, there's really not much of a penalty. We saw Rusty Wallace at Darlington have great pit stops from the backstretch, but it's up to NASCAR to speed that pace car up.
Now, as we mentioned, 25 guys are locked into the field, but Jerry, some critical spots at the back of the pack, and it looks like some guys could go home from here a day early.
Exactly, Bill. Take a look at the qualifying here at Martinsville. Chad Little back in 36th spot, Bobby Hill in 37th. Ricky Craven, who was the pole sitter here in spring, I mean, he was incredible here in qualifying, finds himself back in 38th position. Michael Waltrip, both laps of Michael Waltrip, Citgo Ford, the car slipping and sliding out of turn two, then out of turn four. He's back in 39th. Joe Nemechek has already missed one this year. That was at Darlington. What a tough feeling that was for Joe to go home and take the Burger King clothes and pack them up and watch that weekend. Folks, these guys will have to go again tomorrow in qualifying. But remember, Bill, the forecast for tomorrow is not very good here. They're saying rain across the Blue Ridge Mountains most of the day Saturday, off and on, ending early Sunday morning. And that could end a lot of chances to get in this field for the Haynes 500.
Some guys are going to need a lucky break to make this field. And speaking of breaks, well, that's a popular topic here at Martinsville, isn't it, Benny?
We can never come to this racetrack unless we talk about brakes. But I have seen three brake manufacturers today. I've talked to three of them. They're all here trying to figure out exactly. They want to make the best mousetrap. If they can, every car here would have their brakes on it. But we've got three manufacturers all trying to figure out what they can do to make the brakes last on the cars. And these guys that have started at the back of the field, we talked about them, about the pit stop on the back. What about having to fight their way through traffic? Kyle Petty might have had the best car here in the spring. 7,500 laps, the brakes went away. Robert Presley had a brake problem. So many cars can run so good, but you got to keep brakes on it. That's where Rusty Wallace shines, Bill.
One more thing to keep in mind. We talked about the driver switch between Jeremy Mayfield and John Andretti a couple of weeks ago. Jeremy Mayfield had his best run of the year here in the spring, fourth in the RCA Ford. John Andretti is driving that car now, and he qualified sixth for this race. So look for John Andretti possibly to have a great run here with Tony Furr as his crew chief on Sunday. Also, Bobby Hamilton on the pole. He's never gotten that first Winston Cup win. Could it come here on Sunday? We'll all be here to tell you how it comes out.
All right, thank you, guys. The NASCAR Busch Series teams, of course, take this weekend off, but if the way the season's gone so far is any indication, the final three races should provide an exciting climax to the points championship battle. Last week's race at Dover proved pivotal in the title fight. Randy LaJoy's win cut David Green's lead to a mere 57 points. And although the two contenders are focused on the same goal, they share different approaches. LaJoy has captured his series-leading five wins this season, but Green's calm and consistent style has sustained his points lead most of the year. Pressure is nothing new to Green. This marks the third title fight in 4 years for the 94 champion, who knows what it takes to win it all.
Thank the Lord, I've been through this deal before, and I feel great. I mean, the car's been running really well. Guys have done a great job, and our job's simple. Keep the bad luck away, and we'll be fine.
After finishing 19th in the spring race at Charlotte, Green's team decided they better build and test a new cat for the fall hunt. But LaJoy's team skipped the Charlotte test, focusing instead on preparing for the season's finale in Homestead. Their plans are to bring the same car back to Charlotte that propelled them to a top five finish there 4 months ago. That same car also notched them two wins at Dover.
Same car, same setup. Probably right down to the pound on the weight. That's what we did at Dover, and it worked really good up there. So we're coming back fresh with a good race car, and I can't wait to get here.
In the spring, we didn't feel like we had what we needed for the race. So the guys built a brand new race car, and we're kind of shaking it down. You know, this test at Charlotte is pretty tough because you run in the morning, then the track changes. Then we come back for the race, and the track will change again. So you never catch up. You know, it's just the last three races are going to be pretty action-packed.
Equipment-wise and talent-wise, every week it seems like the two veterans have been evenly matched. And their season-long rivalry has led to many clean but spirited battles on the track. But in the final races, drastic measures are often taken.
I like playing games, probably with everybody. I'll tell a joke or two every now and again and put the pressure on somebody. But I go in and play with David, see how he's running, and I'll tell him I see him slip up over in 3 and 4. So I'll tell him that he's not having a good day.
We've had a great year between the two of us. We've had our differences of opinion, and we've got along well, and we've raced hard. It's going to continue being that way. But he's a professional, and I am too, and we're going to make this Busch Championship one that everybody will remember.
IMSA hopes that its new owner, Roberto Mueller, will bring some major advantages for that sports car racing series. Mueller, a sports marketing expert, owns TMSG, which plans to infuse new capital, broaden management, and develop new strategies for IMSA. IMSA was founded in 1969 and purchased in February 1994 by Charles Slater, a Florida businessman and IMSA driver since 1985. We check out the weekend's television schedule. Of course, the highlight Saturday, the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series from Martinsville at 4 Eastern. We'll be right back. On and off the track with Kenny Mayne and Company, Sunday morning at 11:30 Eastern. It's RPM Today, then RPM Tonight, Sunday night, 8, right here on ESPN2. Trans Am Series wraps up its season in Reno this weekend. Paul Genelozzi led the first round of practice on Friday. Tommy Kendall was second fastest. He can clinch his second straight Trans Am title by finishing sixth or better, qualifying on tap Saturday. That does it for this week. Enjoy the races this weekend, and we'll see you again Monday night. Good night, everybody.